Hello guys and welcome to my channel Departure from the Usual. If you guys like my videos, then don't forget to subscribe my channel, like the video and comment down below. Guys, today I'm going to be talking about Mary Ann Holmes. And this is such a cold case you have never heard of. Mary was living in a predominantly religious town called Thatcher, and this town is in Arizona. She was a single mother of two daughters, 4 years old Ashley and 18 months old Sarah, and she was living in a rented house. Now the town in which she was living is kind of a place where people left their doors unlocked and their windows open at night. Guys, I'm saying this because people felt safe living in this close community. There were no crimes there. But after the incident of 29-year-old Mary, this theory was changed. It was a normal morning of July 9th, 1995, but something horrible was waiting for Mary that day. Someone came back in the back door of Mary's home and violently attacked her. Her clothes had been cut off her body and it appeared that she had been strangled from behind. She had been sexually mutilated and was raped vaginally and anally by an unknown object. She had been hit several times by a sharp object in the head after the torture, possibly the same object she had been raped with. It was later determined that the cause of death was blunt force trauma to the head. Guys, the things you have heard until now must be horrifying for you. But something worse than this happened. The 4-year-old daughter sat with her mom's body for many hours before running to the neighbor's house. She saw all that happened to her mom. She went naked and with her hands bound by rope. She told the neighbor that her mom had been killed, and the neighbor helped call the police. Once the police arrived, they found Mary handcuffed and in the fetal position with blood all over her body. The 18-month-old was still in the house and both girls were left unharmed by whoever killed their mother. The case progressed very slowly. There was very little for police to go off. The 4-year-old daughter, Ashley, drew a gruesome picture of what looked like the crime scene. In the drawing, Mary was laying on the ground with what looked like a knife struck in her head. Police also discovered a bloody shoe print at the scene that was roughly a man's size 11 or 12. And reportedly a fingerprint was found on the handcuffs that were used to restrain her, and a small trace of DNA was also found. But guys, it was 1995 and at that time DNA testing was just getting started. And these proofs were not enough to produce any real leads. Police also got to know about something else. Mary had a yard sale in her yard the day before she died. She had made some good money at this sale, but it was stolen during the attack. One of her neighbor believed that there was a connection between the murder and the yard sale. And the neighbor said this about the yard sale. He said Mary was talking rather loudly about what a good idea the sale was and how much money she was making. And I think the wrong person heard her talking about that. But just like the most other areas of investigation, this lead didn't seem to go away. Police pointed 3 main suspects in Mary's death. The first one is David Black. Now David Black is the son of the owner of the house which Mary was renting. Mary had given David money to fix the back door since it wouldn't lock, but the door was never fixed. It was the same door that the killer used to get into the house. Then the second suspect was John Bursey. John Bursey was Mary's previous boyfriend who lived in Florida. She had filed a police report after he called her and threatened that he was going to come back to Thatcher for her. After her death, police interviewed him, but it was found out that John was not in Arizona at the time of the murder. But the last and the most interesting suspect was Philip Turley. Philip had a deep and unusual obsession with Mary. Some sources say they dated at some point, but other sources say that they were just acquaintances who had gone on one date at some point. Philip told a family member that he was engaged to Mary. but this was obviously not true. He also said that he had bought land in the town of Pima to build a dream house for them. But it wasn't also true. Few years after the case, during an episode of TV show called Cold Justice, an ex-girlfriend of Philip was interviewed and she said that Philip had some unusual fantasies in the bedroom. He liked the kind of fantasy sex from behind, including sodomy and neck restraints. His other ex-girlfriends didn't have much better to say about him. This show made the claim that Philip was most likely the killer based on the circumstantial evidence, such as the fact that he had a size 11 shoe and he was a prison guard, and because of this he had access to handcuffs and a nightstick. And some believe that a nightstick was the item used to rape her. But the guys, the worst part is that the case still remains unsolved to this day. In 2016, Philip was arrested in California for stabbing two people at the age of 53. Philip had been living with this couple in Arizona for some time when they learned of his possible involvement in the case of Mary. The couple started telling others about their discovery, and this thing angered Philip. He confronted the couple with a knife, and a conversation quickly escalated into attempted murder. Philip is right now in the prison serving his 18 years of sentence. Guys, Mary's two daughters, Ashley and Sarah, are still waiting for the police to find out who killed their mother. And they are waiting for their mother to get justice as soon as possible. But up until now, there is no sign of the actual murderer, and he is still roaming around freely somewhere and is a great threat to the society. Guys, what's worse than a mother whose kids watched her die in front of their eyes? What are your thoughts about this case? Tell me in the comments below. I'll meet you next time with another crime story from around the world. Until then, signing off.